Good morning. A lot of fearful people out there. Little story for you. Northern Echo, yesterday, I believe. Home Bargains in Bishop Auckland. They got a pallet of toilet rolls in. And a guy came in and gave him £1,000 for the whole pallet. It's crazy. It's crazy. You know, we live in dark times, and people who live in dark times don't know where they're going and don't know what's happening. And what we're talking about today is being stuck in the mud, dealing with despondency, despair. I want to add another word, and depression. Despondency, despair, and depression. The three D's of darkness. There's a verse which I find fascinating. It's when Moses was going to go and see God in the Sinai. And it says this, and I don't know if you notice the kind of strangeness of this verse. The people remained at a distance while Moses approached the thick darkness where God was. Now, I don't know about you, but I've always understood God is light and in him there's no shadow of turning. That darkness is sort of alien to God. I don't believe he becomes darkness. That's not what this verse is saying. But he is surrounded by darkness in this situation. And what I want to talk about today is these three D's of darkness, which is despair, despondency, and depression, and how God deals with that in our lives. So that's what we're going to be talking about, stuck in the mud today. We're going to be focused on Psalm 13, and Psalm 13 has a verse, verse 3, which in the Amplified reads this: "Consider and answer me, O Lord my God, lighten the eyes of my faith to behold your face in the pitch-like darkness, lest I sleep the sleep of death." I want to tell you a story about a snake who got depressed. The snake went to his doctor. This is where I'm struggling a little bit because I'm not used to this. Snake went to his doctor and said, "Doc, can you do something for me? Something with my eyes, I can't see very well." So he said, "No problem," and he prescribed him a set of glasses, which you can understand in snake world, it's doctors that give you that, not opticians, but there we are. And told him to return in 2 weeks' time. The snake came back in 2 weeks and tells the doctor he's very depressed. And the doctor says, "What's the problem? Didn't the glasses help you?" He says, "Well, I've just discovered I've been living with a water hose for 2 years." I wonder what makes you depressed. I wonder what makes you despondent. I wonder what causes you to get down. You know, sometimes it's that feeling, isn't it? Sadness, a disorder that can be marked by that kind of feeling of sadness. Inactivity, you don't have the desire to do anything. Difficulty in thinking. Concentration, a significant increase or decrease in appetite. And time spent sleeping. Feeling of dejection and hopelessness, and sometimes even suicidal tendencies. Now, you know, we may think that that's something that we shouldn't have as Christians. But the psalmist David did. And I want you to look at this psalm this morning. Psalm 13, we're going to read it. "How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look at me and answer, O Lord my God. Give light to my eyes or I will sleep in death. My enemy will say I have overcome him and my foes will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me." Maybe you feel guilty if you feel like that. Well, David was a pretty big number when it comes to spiritual people. And yet he felt like that. He felt what it was like to feel dejected, despondent, to feel depressed. He had that in him. And you see that contained in the psalm. But he's not the only one. Moses, for example, says this: "I am not able to bear all these people. alone because the burden is too heavy for me. If you treat me like this, please kill me here and now. It's pretty extreme, isn't it? Elijah, but he prayed that he might die and said, it is enough. Now, Lord, take my life, for I am no better than my father's. Job, why did I not die at birth? Why did I not perish when I came from the womb? Jesus, listen to this, began to be very distressed and troubled. This is in the Garden of Gethsemane. And his soul was deeply grieved to the point of death. He also goes on to say, filled with horror and deepest distress. That's the Living Bible version of that. He plunged into a sinkhole of dreadful agony. That's the message. Horror-stricken and desperately depressed. That's the New English Bible. Even Jesus experienced what it was like to be despondent and to be despairing and even to have depression. So, if you feel like that, as a Christian, you've got good company. And there's other people. And you know, I like the fact that Jesus is in this category because the Word of God tells us that he is touched with the feelings of our infirmity. But it goes on to say something else in another part of the scriptures. It says, he knew sin, but he wasn't contained by sin. In other words, he was without sin, it says. So in other words, we can draw a line here and say that depression, despondency, discouragement can be our experience, but they're not sin in themselves because Jesus experienced it and he was without sin. I want you to notice that this whole psalm was written from a cave experience. David was in the cave of Adullam and he was experiencing some pretty grim times. First of all, he'd been on the run from Saul for some time. We'll see in a minute where he went. He was all over the place with this experience of being run from Saul. He was probably tired. He'd just come from a situation where he'd made a massive mistake. He had joined himself to the king of the Philistines and become one of his soldiers, one of his lieutenants. And then people started to say, but you know this David, he used to be the great warrior. You know, he killed Goliath and all this. And he got afraid that something was going to happen to him because of this. So he pretended to be mad. And he let the spittle run down his face. And he, all over the place like this. And as a result, the king of Philistines says, look, I've got enough mad people in my kingdom without another one. And sort of dismissed him. So, but he'd just come from that. That's where he had just come from when he comes to this cave. He's surrounded by some of the most inspiring people. Look at what he's surrounded by. All those who were in distress or debt or discontented gathered round him and he became their leader. About 400 men were with him. Well, I tell you, with friends like that, who wants enemies? So he's surrounded by people who are discontented. He's surrounded by people who are despairing. He's surrounded by that, and he himself is going through some terrible things. The cave experiences that he has, we have too. Sometimes it can be caused by having rough family times. It might be a daughter or a son that's misbehaving or going down wrong tracks and we're concerned about their future. It might be a plummet in health. You've been going great in health and then suddenly, for no reason, you hit a bad spot and you really start to experience bad health. It might be crashes in finance where our money doesn't seem to go like it used to do and it's losing out. It might be a loss of job. Bye, that doesn't half come down when people lose their jobs. My son, about 5 weeks ago, he's in a really well-paid computer job in the States, and he was made redundant. And the reason the company made him and 500 other people redundant was because he was high-paid, and they wanted to reduce their costs, so they took the 500 top-paying people and made them redundant. And in the States, you don't have what we have here, where you have coverage, you know, you have kind of redundancy payments have to be paid. It's a hire and fire mentality in the States. So he got 2 weeks severance, and he was told that he would get maybe something else later on. Well, that's a bit of a shock to the system, when suddenly from, you know, 70, 80,000 pounds a year, you go to nothing with a couple of weeks pay. And he was really, really troubled by that. And of course, he went straight to the business of applying for a job. And I can tell you right now, as of Monday, he starts a new job, which is paying him 25% more than his last job. The only downside to it, and it's been a bit of a downside, he has to travel to the other side of Nashville from where he lives, which is a bit of a commute. And of course, you probably have heard, there's been a tornado gone through Nashville, and it affected his offices as well. I mean, it's affected a lot of buildings, flattened schools and stuff like that. There's power outage at the moment in the office, so I don't know what they're going to do when they start on Monday, but there we are. But the Lord's been good, and I tell you what he did. He put his trust immediately in the Lord. I'm kind of almost going to jump to the last point I'm going to make, which is this. He put his eyes on the Lord straight away. He said, Lord, you've got my life in your hands. I'm yours. And so he trusted the Lord. And he went into interviews, and sometimes they didn't work. You know, they do a thing there where they telephone you first and talk you. And then if you get past that, you get into another telephone conversation with somebody else. Then they might be bringing you into an actual interview and so on. Went through that a few times without any joy. And you can feel the whole thing of going, you know, he used to phone video me to let me know. And you feel his spirit kind of going lower and lower. But he trusted the Lord, and he's come through, which is great. So, here we have this cave experience, loss of job, strains in marriage. Yes, it happens with Christians as well. Sometimes, things can get so strained that you hate each other. It feels like that anyway. And you have to have a breakthrough in that area, or you could end up with a marriage faltering. Even great people like David discover what it's like to feel abandoned by God. And in his psalm, he expresses four cries, which are marked by what the Hebrew calls an erotesis. It's a figure of speech, and it basically means he's asking questions, but he's not expecting any answers. He's not looking for any answers. He's so desperate that he just keeps asking the question, how long? How long? How long? Can you see them on the screen? How long? It's what happens when we get into this particular situation. We cry out to God, God, why have you done this to me? What's happening? Where am I going? And we're not actually waiting to hear if there's any answers. We're just shouting out the questions. And that's what David is doing here. And these four how longs actually represent four cries of his heart, which are about how wounded he feels. Let's have a look at how he is. Four wounds that he experiences. First of all, he cries out, how long will you forget me forever? In other words, my life feels like an endless struggle. My life feels like it. Do you ever feel like that? My life feels like an endless struggle. How long will you forget me forever? I'm going on being hunted by Saul day and night. I don't know when one of his posses are going to arrive. I mean, as you know, one stage, he's in this cave, and Saul turns up with soldiers, and he's outside and doesn't realize David's in the cave. And you know the story about how David went out in the middle of the night. That's how bad it was. You can imagine if David had known that Saul was going to be there, he'd have cleared off to some other cave or gone someplace in the wilderness. But that's what his life was like. He didn't know next what was going to happen. And he had been with the Moabites. He had also been in the wilderness of Ziph. He was an outlaw hiding himself in the cave of Adullam. He'd been a captain with the king of the Philistines. And all the time he's haunted by the fact that he could lose his life at any stage. We know this because in 1 Samuel 27 and verse 1, he says, I shall now one day perish at the hand of Saul. He was expecting to die. So that's one of his woundednesses. He's got this sense of endless struggle. The second one is this. How long will you hide your face from me? In other words, my life seems to have lost God's blessing. Now that's something that we can see in our own lives. It feels like there's no more the blessing of God on our lives. I don't see any more in my home, in my work, in my life, marriage strains, children problems. Don't see any blessing of God there. Early success has been replaced by constant obstacles and personal stagnation. Joy, and I'll tell you, it's not just people in the congregation, members of people in ministry experience this. And I can tell you right now, joy can go from your ministry. And the word can become stale. And worship can become a drudge. And your past can haunt you. There's times when we feel like that. And then the third area, he says, how long must I wrestle with my thoughts? In other words, my mind is so troubled. I can't stop these feelings of dejection and abandonment. The dark thoughts, the uncontrolled emotions, hopelessness. Probably because, first of all, he was in emotional temperament at that time. But secondly, probably he was physically weak. Not getting a great food and so on like that. It's not very strong. Also, being feeling of being let down all the time. And then his fourth area of woundedness is my life seems to have lost God's victory. He says, how long will my enemy triumph over me? I'm constantly defeated. Maybe you feel, as a Christian, there's an area in your life or areas in your life where you constantly, despite the very best intentions, despite the very best efforts, you seem to lose out. You seem to fall. You seem to be defeated in. How long? Those four cries. How long? Endless struggle. How long? God, losing God's blessing. How long will my mind be troubled? How long before I get God's victory in my life again? I'm going to play you a video clip. It's a girl called Mandisa. She's a singer. Beautiful album she produced. And by the way, I can tell you she also comes to a positive conclusion like this psalm. But this particular psalm is a very honest psalm because it expresses how she feels when she loses her best friend, who's just over 30, about 35, and young children. And this is her song.
Prove me wrong.
I wonder if you've ever been there. You know, we try to be stiff-lipped, hold it all together. But sometimes, you know, there are things going on inside of us that are so powerful, we simply suppress them and not deal with them. Mandisa is called, her album is called Out of Darkness, and she actually goes on to actually sketch out how God brings her through, and it's an amazing album to listen to. But that's an honest statement. I wish I could say it ended in that song with a nice little upbeat verse. She does end the album with a very upbeat approach, but she's talking about how she feels. And that's what David's talking about, how he feels. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look at me and answer me. And here's the key to what happens when we are despondent and depressed and discouraged. We've lost sight of God. That's what David has lost. He thinks God's abandoned him. And you can see that in his statement, how long, Lord, will you forget me forever? He loses focus. His situation, because God's no longer at the heart of it all, has become hopeless. And hopelessness is the basis, by the way, of depression. Thankfully, I have to say, he doesn't stay in the pit. If you look at verse 5, he's coming out of it by the end of the psalm. But, you know, the enemy of our souls will try, first of all, to destroy our concept of God. He'll try to destroy that idea that God will never leave me and never forsake me, that he will abandon me. And if he can destroy that, then he'll move on to the second concept that he'll try and destroy in our lives, which is the concept that we are a child of God. See, he cannot touch the fact that we have a standing in Christ Jesus. We have a position that he can't touch that. But he can make us believe that we're no longer that special person that God loves, his child. And those two most important beliefs, that God is with you and he will never abandon you, and that you are his child and he will always take care of you, are at the heart of where you come from when you get into this situation. Coming out of despondency and discouragement. Without these, we lose a sense of hope and we lose a sense of future and we plunge into despair and depression. But look at the turning point. We find it in verse 3. And he says three things. He had four cries before when he was expressing his heart. Now he cries out three things. And the three things are, first of all, look. And then he says, answer. And finally he says, give me light in my eyes. Let me look at those a bit closer. He says, look, Lord, look at me. And David has felt that God has turned his back on him. And now he asked the Lord to turn around and look at him. But it's more than that. Look at the verse. He actually says, take my face into your hands. Look me in the eyes. You know, I was watching a little documentary about the Great North Ambulance, Air Ambulance. And the situation was a little lad had had a smash. He'd had one of these, you know, these motorized motorbikes that kids get. And he hit a wall and he'd gone over it and had a smash and he was in a lot of pain. The air ambulance was brought in and the doctor went, and the first thing the doctor said, and he said this was very interesting, he has kids himself, so he says you have to kind of make them feel you can be trusted. And he says, this little lad had his face turned like that, and he said to him, he turned his head round, he says, look at me, look at me. Looked him in the eyes, he says, I'm going to look after you, I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to deal with your pain. I'm going to deal with what's going on. And that little lad, by the time I saw him at the end, when he was in hospital in, I think it was the RVI, he was actually as chirpy as anything because he had an ambulance ride. He had an air ambulance ride, you know, and the helicopter and all the rest of it. He was as chirpy. But the doctor turned him around, look at me. That's what God wants to do with us. He wants us to look deeply into his heart, into his eyes, and hear what he has to say. Secondly, he says, answer me. What he's saying there is, I haven't heard from you for such a long time, Lord, and I want to hear your voice in my life again. Talk to me again. I want to hear that voice that you speak. Sometimes it'll be a little quiet voice inside, but I want to hear you speaking to me again. And the third thing he says, which is down here, give light to my eyes, or as the NLT puts it, restore the sparkle to my eyes. What he's saying, restore me. Restore me. Put the sparkle back into my eyes. What kind of sparkle was there? Well, God had spoken to him a long time ago when he was just a shepherd boy who was going to make him king over Israel. Give me that sense of purpose again, that vision, that sense of knowing where I'm going again, Lord. Restore me and restore that to me again. You said you'd never leave me. Let me know your presence. You said you would love me to the uppermost. Let me know your power. You said you would comfort me. Let me know your peace. If you've ever felt abandoned, what that actually says is at one time you were not. Because you can't feel abandoned if you're at one stage or felt received. Do you understand? So abandonment itself is a proof that you've been near God and God is with you. And that awareness should be there all the time with us, that God is near, and he's nearer to us than our feelings. We need to remind ourselves that when we're walking in the darkness, God was near, and he is near, even though we can't see him. And we need to learn something which is really powerful and important, because depression and discouragement and despair and all these things are emotional feelings. And they can overtake us. They can become much more substantial in our lives than anything else. But what we need to do is we need to learn to agree with God. Now, how do you do that? You learn to agree with God through his word, what he says. And when we learn to agree with God, we take me and I out of the center and we put God back into the center. We learn to agree with God. That's how he can say in this psalm, I trust in your unfailing love, even though he feels he's in the dark. Even though he feels he's been abandoned by the Lord, even though he can't experience the presence of God or the voice of God, he says, I trust in your unfailing love. Psalm 34 and verse 18 says, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. That's lovely, isn't it? When you are caught up in the throes of depression or despair or discouragement, let me say this. Draw near to God. Put your eyes on him. And even though he doesn't seem to be there and the heavens are like brass and you don't seem to be getting through, begin to realize that you can pray a prayer that the psalmist prayed in Psalm 57, verse 1. Have mercy on me, O Lord. Have mercy on me. For in you my soul takes refuge. I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings until the disaster has passed. Jesus is the safest refuge we can ever have. One stage in my own ministry, I went through a very, very rough patch. Things went really badly wrong, and it felt like everything had gone wrong. And in that situation, I remember I was driving my car and down this road, and the road had a sharp right bend, and in front, on that section where you turned right, was a brick wall. And this intense feeling came over me just to put the throttle down and go smashing into the wall. That's how bad I felt. And in that, this was all done in split seconds, by the way, because I'm not that fast. But as I drove towards the wall with this feeling that I should just smash into it, another picture came into my heart about my wife, Anne, and the two kids. What are you going to do? Leave them alone. And I realized it was a very selfish thing, so I swung around and didn't bother. But you know, we can get to a real point of despair sometimes. Real point of despair. And when we are, it's useful to know there are other people who share that despair. Martin Luther was a sufferer of depression on many occasions in his life. And one of his deepest, darkest moments, when he felt utterly cut off from God, he wrote this hymn. A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing, our helper he, amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate, on earth is not his equal. It's kind of old-fashioned English, you realize. Did we in our own strength confide? Our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Just ask who that may be. Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord, so boweth is his name, from age to age the same, and he must win the battle. And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. Our little word shall fell him. For a guy who's in deep depression, that's a great hymn. He knew what it was for the God of his, who's a mighty fortress in his life, to come through for him. Folks, whenever you get stuck in the mud, despair, discouragement, despondency, just turn to the Lord. Fix your eyes on him. Remember that the enemy's approach will be to try and destroy your concept that God is near and the concept that you are the child of God who you never will forget. Hold on to that so that you come through. May God bless you. Amen.